we're at the racetrack. And then we're at the starting gate. And then what we've got are these horses called 8 o'clock people, and 9 o'clock meat people, and 10:30 regular people here for the regular time of the service. And we're all getting in the starting gate to begin a new year. And at some point, someone's going to yell, "They're off." So, they're off. We are starting a brand new program here. But more than that, we are starting a brand new way of being St. Philip's. Since January, your vestry and other leaders in this congregation have been working to create a different way of being the Church of St. Philip. A different way of organizing ourselves. A different way of calling each other to accountable ministry. By which I mean you and I are becoming accountable to one another for making sure that we are each growing in our faith. That we are each developing a relationship with God who is at hand and who we can know more deeply and more together. We're going to do that in a way that is consistent with this growing congregation, consistent with its size, and consistent with its complexity. And it's not going to happen overnight. It's going to take 3 years. Now, 2 years from now, it will look more clear to you than it looks right now. And 1 year from now, it'll look less clear than it will 2 years from now. But we are in the middle of change. Now, you know, there are three answers to that age-old question: how many Episcopalians does it take to change a light bulb? The first answer is change. Change? Who said anything about change? The second is, one, to get a ladder and take the light bulb out, two, to mix the martinis. And the third is, it takes three, one to change the light bulb, and two to extol the virtues of the previous light bulb. And those are, in fact, the three kinds of people that we will be dealing with in this time of change and transition. There will be those who hate it. For those of you who hate it, I apologize now. There will be those of you who will remember the good old days. For those of you who remember the good old days, they were neither good or old. And for those of you who just get it done, have a drink and relax. Because what we are doing is based on a whole heck of a lot of work by the leaders of this congregation. I'm talking about just the strategic plan. Took over 20 hours of meeting time by a dozen people, and then at least that amount of time outside of meetings to put together the plan. For your vestry, we are next Saturday having our fourth 8-hour meeting in addition to the regular vestry meetings and a vestry overnight and work in between the meetings. And what this is all going to look like will, in the next several weeks, be explained to you. 2 weeks from today at 9 o'clock, we are unveiling the strategic plan. If you care about it or want to know about it, you can find it on the website or you can be here at 9 o'clock. The virtue of being here at 9 o'clock is you can ask questions. It is very hard to question the tape when you're watching it on your computer. Everything that we are doing, we will tell you about. There is no cabal or plot. There are no people trying to take over the church. And parenthetically, the bishop doesn't even know what we're doing and won't until Wednesday, when the senior warden and the junior warden and I will meet with the bishop to share what we've done. So this is not a plot by the diocese to take over St. Philip's. This is not a plot by the vestry to take over St. Philip's. This is not a plot by the strategic planning committee to take over St. Philip's. This is a plot for all of us to become St. Philip's. And it is rooted in a concept. And this is the concept. Whenever two or three are gathered together, I will be there with you. You just heard that in today's gospel. When we are gathered together, I will be in the midst of you. Now, I got to thinking about that this week, and I was wondering, I wonder what you make of that. And I thought there's lots of ways to think about that. You could say, like, okay, that means that we're walking with Jesus. Does that mean he's got a notepad and he's taking down notes? Is he a kind of cosmic CIA guy? Does that mean he's the cosmic Santa Claus, making a list of who's naughty and who's nice? What does it mean to say, to affirm, to believe that Jesus is in the midst of us right now? What does that mean to you? What does it mean? Is that good news? You know, some people are nodding their heads, some people are going, maybe. I often, you know, talk to congregations, I say, you know, if I told you that you were going to die 1 year from now, what would you do? And they all say, well, I'd go to Europe, and I would max out my credit cards, and I would party every night, and I'd tell my boss what I really think of, and I say, okay, good. Now, if Jesus were coming a year from now, it's going to be the end of the world, what would you do? Oh, I'd do Bible study and prayer. Ask yourself this question. If Jesus is in the midst of us right now, what are we doing? How are we being the church? How are we dealing with one another? You know, the Gospel of Matthew has that section you just heard about, well, if you have a complaint with one another, and I know this for a fact, okay, I'm gonna tell a secret now, okay? But some of you have complaints with others of you. I'm not making that up. If Jesus is in the middle of us, Jesus' prayer for us is that we be one. That's what he prayed for his disciples. Do you remember? The night before he died, he prayed that they would be one as he and the Father was one. What are we doing to reconcile with one another? Well, Matthew's gospel has a way you can do that. It's a way. There's lots of other ways. But it begins with, stop trying to hide. Be honest. I mean, the reality is Jesus is in the midst of us. Jesus already knows. And people say, well, I can't be mad at God. Yeah, were you hiding it from God? When I was a vicar of a small mission in Long Island, there was a couple, and she died. She was 38 years old, leaving three children. And I had to do the funeral. And there I was at the altar and in the pulpit, preaching resurrection is what we do at funerals. And I looked over at this guy, and he was mad. He was angry. He was red in the face, smoke coming out of his ears, angry. And who could blame him? And we went through the service, and I'm in the middle of doing the consecration prayer, and I look at the guy, and he had this vision on his face that was almost beatific. It was beautiful. All of that anger was gone. And so much later in the day, after we'd been through all of the stuff you do in funerals, I took him aside and said, what happened? He said, I was angry. He said, yeah, no, I saw you. I said, oh, I was really angry. And I knelt down and I said the following prayer. Pardon me. I'm quoting him. He said, God damn you, God. I am so angry. And a voice came to me, he said, and said, I know that, I can work with that. Just stay near me. And I knew it was going to be okay. I was still angry. I'm not denying that. But I knew it was going to be okay. Because God was with me. And even my anger could not push God away. And God is with you and me. And even our concern and our confusion and our likes and dislikes and all of those things that help us to stay apart from one another will not drive God away from us. So we need to explore where God is. We need to name where God is. And I can tell you right now, looking out at this congregation, up at this congregation, that God is in the midst of us. And that is so incredible. It is so marvelous. And so, as we're off into a new year, let's make a covenant with one another to point out where God is when we see God, to help one another to see God when we can't, and to love one another as Paul suggests that we do. Keep that great commandment that with Christ we will be one. Amen.